Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdusalam AbuHanifa. Hajj, this world well-known ritual, is about to grace us again. It is that time of the year where one of the greatest gathering in the Muslim world is just about to come and grace us. This event is not about just a trip to a place for a few days, do a few rituals here and there, then get back home with the promise of a lifetime, and that is getting back home fully pardoned, and that's that. And now, all what a pilgrim has to do is keep a very low profile, and this way the route to Jannah is all sure and certain. To some, if not to the majority of Muslims out there, Hajj is almost like a born-again new Muslim. So, is Hajj really just 5 days rituals for a life pardon? Or is there something else to it? If I were really to just copy everyone else, then I would just reiterate what most people and men of religion say. Go to Hajj and come home forgiven, and that's that. But the truth is, where is the testimony for the sake of Allah? And where is that promise that Allah has taken upon everyone who has knowledge to preach what Allah wants without any personal views or arguments? So let us take the journey to really appreciate and understand this ritual as a manner that would help us in our life today and when we perform Hajj, and also when we die and go meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Obviously, Hajj is well known. It's even classified as one of the 5 pillars of Islam. Today, I will speak about Hajj not as a pillar of Islam, but a ritual that comes back to us every year, and also about the sacrifice that a Muslim endeavors and undertakes within this period of the year. But first thing first, what is the meaning of the word Hajj, which people translate into pilgrimage? Well, the root word has got few meanings, but they all gravitate around Hajj, which is a need, which is also a half of the word Hajj. So when we say Hajj, it means also evidence. وَحَاجَّهُ قَوْمُهُ, it means that his people have evidenced him, they have brought the evidence. So as you can see here, the Ha and the Jim are all root letters for the word need. And also, when we say somebody has Hajj al-Iraq, it means they went to al-Iraq for a matter that they need. As such, the widely known term of Hajj, that is pilgrimage in English, it actually is not the true meaning in Arabic. It's the approximate translation into English, but it does not really portray the Arabic meaning of the word Hajj. Because in Arabic, the term Hajj is when you set on a journey for a matter that you want to accomplish, something that you need to fulfill. If you go and you undertake a journey to a place with no particular purpose, we cannot call that Hajj. It's just a journey. So from here, when we say someone Hajj ila baytillah, i.e. someone has gone to the house of Allah, meaning there is something Hajj, something that is in the house of Allah or in Mecca, Baytullah al-Haram, the sacred house of Allah, that is Mecca, the Kaaba, and all where people perform Hajj, that there is something of a need that they need that is there. They are going there to bring it back with them. And in this pep talk, inshallah, we shall see what it is that when you go to Hajj, you should bring back home with you that's going to last you of a lifetime. Not the eternal pardon there, but something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to get back home with. Now that we know the meaning of Hajj, and that is to set on a journey to a place, in which case here is to Mecca, for something that is there of ours that we're going to come home with. So what it is that Muslims set off and will always set off to get back home with? Many answers can be given to this question, but I will uncover Hajj from a completely different perspective that will help you change in your life and not think of it just as an event that took place in the past. distance past that is a time of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and that every year we celebrate something that dates about 7,000 years or 8,000 years ago, because Hajj has absolutely nothing to do with what has happened in the past. In fact, Hajj is always something to do with what's going on today. Now, before I set on to speak about Hajj, I want to speak about the direction of Mecca. Why Hajj happens in Mecca? Because believe it or not, and this might seem like a strange thing to say, but again, believe it or not, there are some voices out there that are calling to encourage each country to build a Kaaba-like in their own country so that the people of that country would make Hajj to the Kaaba in the land. For example, if for us here in England, we might build a Kaaba here and make our pilgrimage here. Now, these voices are usually motivated by politics, because what they see is that the royal family of the children of Saud use what belongs to all Muslims, because the Kaaba and the Medina and all those Islamic sacred places belong to all Muslims, and they are not, absolutely not, the belongs of the Saudi government or people. So these people that have problems with the Saudi family, they say that we should all either own to Mecca and every year a country takes care of it, or we build the Kaabas in our homelands and we make Hajj there and let the children of Saud die out of poverty. But for what it is, this act of hijacking Hajj has already been done before by a group of Muslims known as Al-Qaramita. Al-Qaramita were a group of people that separated from Al-Fatimiyun. The Fatimiyun are people that pledge their allegiance to Fatima, the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Long story short, because I don't want to speak about Al-Qaramita nor about the Fatimiyun, but what these people did, they attacked the house of Allah 317 years after the migration of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is 3 centuries, 17 years. In our Christian time, that is 908 years, well, that is 1,900 years ago. They killed everyone in the Kaaba. Mecca, they killed everyone. And then they stole the black stone for 22 years. And they built a Kaaba in the eastern parts of Saudi Arabia. And they forced people to make Hajj to that Kaaba. They also tried to steal Maqam Ibrahim, the place where Ibrahim alayhi salam is in Mecca, if you've been there. But alhamdulillah, they could not, and they did not manage to do that. And then again, this is one of the trials or tentatives that people have tried to steal Al-Kaaba or anything to do with Hajj and make it in their own lands. Al-Qaramita, again, the inhabitants of Al-Bahrain today are still in harmony with the Saudis, believe it or not. Those that killed all those who refused to perform Hajj in their own lands today are becoming Allah, and the Qaramita still exist in Al-Bahrain. That's another story for another day. The belief that Islam has always been politicized is very felt in the Muslim world around. It is very sad indeed to see Islam being used to serve politics, and this is extremely apparent these days in the state built by the family of Saud. A state that rests on countless Muslim souls taken by the might of the sword since the infernal alliance between the king, Saud, Muhammad Saud, and the appointed man of religion, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Look at how the Saudi government today uses Hajj to punish Muslims of Qatar. And were it not because of international pressure, believe it or not, the Saudis would never have allowed the Qatar people to make Hajj this year. But under the boots of America and the West, suddenly Saudi Arabia agreed that the people of Qatar can make Hajj. But because of this air embargo, of all those nonsense, stupid rules taken by these so-called Muslim rulers against this Islamic State, the king of Saudi Arabia said, we will send the Saudi planes to go to Qatar, pick up the pilgrims, take them to perform Hajj, all on his. He will pay on everything. It's all on his account. And then send them back to Qatar. The Qatari government said, no, we don't want this act of charity. We just want you to let Muslims go to perform Hajj and not use Hajj for political ends. This is a sad fact today. No scholars, No, those people that make us see hell. If you shaved your beard or if you don't cover your face, you don't wear the niqab, they make you see that you're going to eternity for hellfire. You don't hear them speak these days when a Muslim government that is so-called Saudi, the Salafi people, declaring war on a Muslim land. Let's assume for a second here that the government has got an issue with the government of Qatar. But this is government and government. Why are the Qatari people, the regular day-to-day Muslims, paying the price of political quarrels? And they say, you love for the sake of Allah and you hate for the sake of Allah. But to the Saudi people, nobody is really to be loved unless they sing to the tunes of the king of Saudi Arabia. Something I pray to Allah that will change someday. But in any way, it is well known that the Saudi government serves the interest of the 5,000 princes and princesses, while the rest of the enslaved population, both in its utmost poverty, they bathe in poverty like you've never seen that before. This is why in Saudi Arabia, you can't go from a city to another city without a permit. You need a permit. It's like London to go to Birmingham. You need a permit to travel. This is exactly in Saudi Arabia because they don't want you to see what is really going on in there. But in any way, and to guarantee the calm to do as they want, and this is the politicians, they recruit the man of religion and preachers to control people with a side of Islam mostly created by paid men of religion. As today, Hajj has got more politics, corruption, and under-the-table deals than any other rituals. And having worked with the Islamic centers personally, I know what the people that take pilgrimage to Mecca need to go through to get visas and to get all those things. If they don't cough, they don't get the deals. And this is a sad truth. Now, not to dwell on this issue longer than it should, especially that this is not a how politics influence Islam, but this is something about Hajj. So let us move on to the next point, and that is, when can Hajj be performed? Now, you might look at me with an eyebrow raised. What do you mean, when can Hajj be? Isn't that Hajj in the first 10 days of the Hijjah? Well, it is impossible to overlook the human factor in this type of Islam we have today. And by taking the simplest of looks into the Book of Allah, we find that there are two distinct times where Hajj can be performed. Yes, Hajj is not only performed in the first 10 days of the Hijjah. This is one Hajj that you can perform. But there is another type of Hajj that you can perform. So let's see what the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell us about this. Before going into what Allah says about Hajj, let's see how Hajj has always been, the history of Hajj. Because since Hajj has always been used by the Muslim governments to conclude their annual meetings, and where Muslims from all other lands gathered at the same spot, Hajj was the most feared time of the year. What I mean by this, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, when he became Khalifa, he used to meet all the governors of the land in Hajj year. Because in Hajj, everybody came to Hajj, so he would sit there and have his AGM, annual general meeting. Umar ibn al-Khattab did the same thing, and so did Uthman, and so did everyone else. So Hajj was really the yearly gathering when Muslims got together, and if they didn't like something, you will see it right there and then. So Hajj, as consequence to that, became the very feared ritual that every governor, every ruler feared throughout the year. Perhaps this explains why the early leaders of Bani Umayyah only acknowledged one type of Hajj and cited the other. I will explain further. As plain as it is, the governed Islam refuses to submit to the command of Allah, believe it or not, even today. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has spoken about two types of Hajj. There is the regular Hajj, and there is Al-Hajjul Akbar, the bigger or the greater Hajj. So, let's start with the regular Hajj. When can it be performed? I won't go into details about how Hajj is performed because really it's really simple. It's not that complicated at all. Because also there is no difference between Al-Hajjul Akbar, the greater Hajj, and the regular Hajj. Listen to what Allah says in the Qur'an and see what Muslims are doing today, and you will see that we Muslims deliberately are stubborn and don't want to listen to Allah. Allah says in Surah Al-Baqarah, in the ayah 197, that is the surah number 2, and the ayah 197. Please open up your Qur'an, if you have one right in front of you, or get a translation of the meanings of the Qur'an. You will read something along those lines. أَوْذُ بِاللَّهِ مِشْتَانُ الرَّجِيمُ الْحَجُّ أَشْهُرٌ مَعْلُومَاتٌ. The Hajj is a well-known months with the S, it's plural of months. فَمَنْ فَرَضَ فِيهِنَّ الْحَجِّ, whoever intends to perform Hajj in these months, فَلَا رَفَثَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ وَلَا جِدَالَ فِي الْحَجِّ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lays down certain things that a pilgrim must not do, that is quarrel, fight, lie, and all these things. So as you can see here, Allah says, الْحَجُّ أَشْهُرٌ مَعْلُومَاتٌ, i.e. Hajj can be performed in a set number of months, that is the plural of 1 month. But we today, the Hajj we have today is only few days, that is only 5 days. So how come the Quran tells us the Hajj can be done within months? And today we are being said, our scholars tell us, that Hajj can be done within days. When our scholars wanted to debate what months can Hajj be performed in, they again differed about these days. Some of them, they said, these are the 4 months Al-Ashhur Al-Hurum, the 4 months, the sacred months, which are Dhul-Qa'dah, Dhul-Hijjah, that is the 11th and 12th months of the Muslim year, Safar, the first month, and Rajab, the 7th month. So as you can see here, they say any of these 4 months, Hajj can be performed in any of these 4 months. Others said, no. Hajj starts, the four months of Hajj start right after Ramadan. That is Shawwal, Dhul-Qa'dah, Dhul-Hijjah, and Muharram. So any of these 4 months, you can perform Hajj in them. But because we Muslims have never really seen the full beauty of Islam as Allah intends it, the Hajj that Allah wants might never see the light, unless the greed of politics goes off. Otherwise, Allah knows when we will see the beauty of this religion. Because Hajj is to be performed within 4 months, any time of the year, within those 4 months, is considered Hajj. But politics today insist that it is only 5 days in the year. So where the Hajj we perform today come from? Well, the time for the 5 days of Hajj that Muslims crowd themselves at the price of their death and human stampede, well, there is another ayah where Allah defines and names a Hajj that took place at this time of the year, i.e. within the first 10 days of the Hijjah, and he called it, subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Hajjul Akbar. In Surah Al-Tawbah, that is the 9th surah, please don't say chapter is in the Bible, and don't say verse is in the Bible. We must call the surah as Allah named it, surah, not chapter. It's not permitted to call it a chapter. And the ayah is not a verse. Call it ayah as Allah wants it to be called. So in surah number 9, within the first 3 ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala points us to the number of those months where Hajj is performed. But he also shows the difference between the 2 types of Hajj. Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, بَرَاءَةٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ إِلَى الَّذِينَ عَاهَدْتُمْ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. Freedom from all obligation of peace is declared from Allah and His Messenger to the polytheists and idolaters with whom we made a treaty back then. فَسِيحُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ أَرْبَعَةَ أَشْهُرٍ. So, travel freely in the land for 4 months, as you will. وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّكُمْ غَيْرُ مُعْجِزِ اللَّهِ. And know that you cannot withhold nor escape from the punishment of Allah. وأذان من الله ورسوله إلى الناس يوم الحج الأكبر. And this is a declaration from Allah and His Messenger to the people made on the day of the greatest Hajj. So when Rasulullah ﷺ performed Hajj in the 10 days of the Hijjah, Allah named it Al-Hajj al-Akbar, the great Hajj. So here we have two Hajjs, so to speak. Hajj that is performed within the four sacred months. And that means if you want to do Hajj in the Al-Qa'dah, you can go and perform Hajj the 5 days and you can slaughter your animal and come home, and that is considered a Hajj. If you want to do the greater Hajj, then you go within these first 10 days and you performed in the five days of these 10 days of the Hijjah, and that is considered Al-Hajj Al-Akbar. This is the Hajj that our Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam performed for the purpose of delivering this kind of amnesty to those who were enjoying peace treaty with our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So what we Muslims are doing today is conducting the greatest Hajj only, not the regular other Hajj that Allah wants. Again, there are two types of Hajj. One type of Hajj, the minor Hajj, so to speak, because Al-Hajj al-Akbar and there is Al-Hajj al-Asghar. So there is a smaller Hajj, the bigger Hajj. The smaller Hajj, and it is a Hajj, Allah called it a Hajj, Al-Hajj Ashhur al-Ma'lumat. It means Hajj can be performed in a set number of months. I insist on the S at the end of month, plurals. And that means if you go within any of the 4 months, that is accepted and considered full Hajj. If you go in the Hijjah these days, that is the greater Hajj. The element of crowdness and mass murdering due to the human stampede, the expensiveness of trips of today, the scarcity of hotels, the marketing tricks played on by the different businesses is pushing the ritual of Hajj out of reach from a huge number of people. Add to that, that the imposed quota of allowed people to perform Hajj everywhere by the Saudi government on all different countries, where some people's names come after 10 years of waiting. Where is the beauty and simplicity of Islam in all this? Why doesn't the Saudi government, who has hijacked the Kaaba and the Medina, allow people to perform Hajj as Allah says it in Al-Quran within 4 months? Why? Because politics rules, and our scholars of Islam, they don't speak about these issues, especially in Saudi Arabia, because they all support the government. Because if they spoke and the government doesn't want to, most of those men of religion will end up in jails. Now imagine if Hajj was conducted within the four sacred months. Set your imagination free. Imagine how beautiful our Muslim world would be. But politics have always muddied up the purity of Islam. And to Allah we complain. These politics, since the struggle after the murdering of Uthman and since Banu Umayyah took power, Islam became all politicized until today. So what is the purpose of Hajj? Books upon books have been and can be written about what Hajj can bring into someone's life, how to perform it for the purpose it was meant for. Many people link Hajj to the distant past, the far distant past, and link it to the mere historical events that took place at the time of the noble messenger of Allah, Ibrahim alayhi as-salam, the man who started it all. And all that is being done today is a result or a byproduct of what happened once. Allah gifted Ibrahim with two children. So this is the general concept of people. Two boys they were. As is agreed between the Qur'an, and also it is present in the Old Testament. The firstborn was Ismail alayhi salam, and the second was Isaac or Ishaq alayhi salam. Without going too much into details at this stage, because I'm doing a full research about the building of the Kaaba and the story of Ibrahim, and I will get back to this story about Ishmael and Isaac, or Ismail and Ishaq. But for now, I want to say there is a fierce difference and contradictory arguments between the scholars of Islam since the early days until today as who was the potential child that Ibrahim was going to slaughter. Some of our scholars, and a great number of them, they say it was Ismail, and another huger number said no, it was not Ismail, it was Ishaq alayhi as-salam. As obvious as it might seem, but the sneaky import from those people of the book, these are the Jews, externally embraced Islam when internally injecting their own stories in our Islam has completely muddied up everything, or at least most of everything, about this issue. Who was the potential child to be slaughtered? Many ahadith are reported today as if they were a saying of the Prophet, when in fact they are narration from the people of the book. Again, this is not the moment to dig deep into this, but the impact of the Ka'b al-Ahbar, a Jew who embraced Islam at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then his close friendship with Abu Huraira has caused a great concern to the scholars of hadith. So much so that in Sahih Ibn Hibban alayhi rahmatullah, a great scholar of hadith, there is an authentic hadith where Abu Huraira was speaking about the creation of Adam being on Jumu'ah and what happened at the angels. Someone asked him, "Ya Abu Huraira, is this a hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or did you hear it from someone else?" He said, "I heard it from Ka'b al-Ahbar, but Abu Huraira was reporting it as if it were a hadith." So who was this almost slaughtered child? There has been a huge discussion between our scholars about who was the child that Ibrahim alayhi salam attempted to slaughter. I will not provide the Quranic evidences as to whom it was, as this will be discussed, as I said, when I tackle who built the Kaaba research. But quickly, I would say that Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, the greatest interpreter or the mufassir of the meanings of the Quran, they call him Sayyidul Mufassirin, the master of those who explained some of the meanings of the Quran. He believed and said that Ishaq alayhi salam was the to-be-slaughtered child. This was also the opinion of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, and from a group of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and their followers. The other opinion is held by some late scholars. So in the early days of Islam, Muslims at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and after that, they believed that the child was Ishaq. It's only of late that some late scholars, as Ahmed ibn Hanbal and few others, said that the slaughtered child is Ishmael. This is why in Saudi Arabia, they hold that it is Ishmael. On the other hand, also, there is a huge fight between Muslims and Jews in Israel and Palestine. So as soon as we say Ishaq, they will label you, you have betrayed. You kind of like you are giving a side, you are siding with the Jews. You say that it is Isaac, Ishaq, that was the slaughtered kid. But away from the politics, again, a huge number of our scholars believed it is Ishaq and not Ishmael. Again, this topic, I will discuss it more in details when I speak about my research about who built the Kaaba. As for here now, and what I would like to say, that the truth of the matter is that only Allah knows who the to-be-slaughtered child was. Again, this is just for now. Later on, I will provide a more in-depth explanation. And knowing which is really not important at all. As Al-Imam Az-Zujaj said, alayhi rahmatullah, he said, the truth of the matter is that Allah knows who of the boys was the one to be slaughtered. Then he added, there are so many contradictory opinions between the scholars, and further said, till this hour, And I am talking here about 250, 300 years after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he says, till this hour, I do not know who the to-be-slaughtered child was, because every time an opinion wins over the other, another evidence balances the arguments against the other. It's an unbelievable argument. Who was the slaughtered? Ishmael, Ismail, or Ishaq alayhima as-salam. As already mentioned, the hadith of Ana ibn Dhabihain, I am the son of the two to be slaughtered children, is a fabricated hadith. It's reported by Al-Hakim in his Mustadrak, but his chain of narrators and the content of it is extremely, extremely weak. Rasulullah ﷺ is not the son of Ismail, i.e. Ismail was not to be slaughtered, even though he is, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, descended from Ismail. And also that the famous story about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's father, Abdullah, was going to be slaughtered. So his father would offer 10 camels, and then they will draw again, and they kept coming until it was 100 camels. Then he slaughtered them. All that story is a fabricated story. It doesn't stand at all. You might be surprised, but that is the truth of the matter. The reason I mention this argument is to point out that the reason we slaughter is not, and I will repeat it, the reason we slaughter every year is not linked to what took place between Ibrahim alayhi salam and his son. We do not slaughter to thank Allah that Ibrahim didn't slaughter his child. But it is rather an independent act from that took place before. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا وَعَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ يَأْتِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍّ عَمِيقٍ. Allah commands Ibrahim alayhi salam, after he purified the Kaaba, Allah commands Ibrahim, telling him in the meeting, proclaim Hajj unto mankind, i.e. call mankind to come perform Hajj. And they shall respond by coming on foot and every lean camel or any means of transportation. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ, so that they witness beneficial things for them. So we go to Hajj to actually witness beneficial things for us in Hajj and also in the hereafter. وَيَذْكُرُ اسْمَ اللَّهِ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْلُومَاتٍ, and that they mention the name of Allah, that is in Hajj, in an appointed number of days. Remember always when Allah says فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْلُومَاتٍ, i.e. in an appointed number of days, it's within the 4 months. So anywhere you go, you perform Hajj the 5 days, that's your time. عَلَى مَا رَزَقَهُمْ مِنْ بَهِيمَةِ الْأَنْعَامِ, for what he has provided for them of the cattle, the beasts, and they are the sheep, the goat, camels, cows, and the likes. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَكُلُوا مِنْهَا وَأَطْعِمُوا الْبَائِسَ الْفَقِيرِ. So Allah tells us, then eat thereof, of these animals, and feed with it the poor who are destitute, and the poor who do not ask, but they are there sitting in front of you. Then few further ayat in Surah Al-Hajj, so there is a whole surah of Al-Hajj, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explained the purpose of the Hajj, which I will mention to you now. So a few ayat later, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأُحِلَّتْ لَكُمُ الْأَنْعَامِ إِلَّا مَا يُتْلَى عَلَيْكُمْ. The cattle are lawful to you, except those mentioned to you, and that is the pig and the dead animals and the blood and things that are made haram unto us. And then again, in the same surah of Surah Al-Hajj, in the ayah 33, Allah says, لَكُمْ فِيهَا مَنَافِعُ إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ مُسَمَّى ثُمَّ مَحِلُّهَا إِلَىٰ الْبَيْتِ الْعَتِيقِ. You have in them the cattle, these are the animals we eat and they live with us, benefits for you till an appointed term. ثُمَّ مَحِلُّهَا إِلَىٰ الْبَيْتِ الْعَتِيقِ, then after that, their abode or their final destination is to the ancient house in Mecca to be slaughtered. Furthermore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights the purpose of Eid al-Adha and Hajj altogether. And even though the purpose is clear, human interpretations took that beautiful divine concept and made it into some historical matter. A man wanted to slaughter his son, so we do it today to thank Allah that Ibrahim didn't slaughter Ismail or Ishaq. This is how the book of Allah gets put on the back benches, while unmanned events are celebrated instead. No wonder our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam will and shall report our wide misdeeds of abandoning the teachings of Al-Quran and are just hanging on to what culture, politics, and humans are teachings and preaching. Please pay attention to this unbelievable statement that all of us will hear and witness on the day of judgment. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will stand up, the Messenger, he will stand up. وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ. And the Messenger shall say on that day of judgment facing all Muslims, Ya Rabbi, inna qawmi ittakhadhu hadha al-Qur'an mahjura. My Lord, my people have indeed taken this Qur'an abandoned. The criterion to differentiate between the wrong and correct, between the halal and haram, has been abandoned. Anyway, let's keep looking into the meaning of Eidul Adha. And the question to ask is, are Muslims the only ones that celebrate this type of event? Well, as it turns out, Muslims are not the only ones that do. But those that should have celebrated the divine gift of cattle have somehow deviated from this deed. This is because Allah has mentioned that so many nations, or all nations, have been appointed a ritual to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we do in Eid al-Adha. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ جَعَلْنَا مَنْسَكًا لِيَذْكُرُوا اسْمَ اللَّهِ عَلَى مَا رَزَقَهُمْ مِنْ بَهِيمَةِ الْأَنْعَامِ. And to every nation, i.e. every human being out there, have been assigned a way to religiously celebrate the name of Allah over his gift of the beast of the cattle to them as rizq. Any human being on earth, Chinese or South American or Latin or North or the Polars or whatever, have been given a set of religious duties that they should do yearly basis to thank Allah and to be acknowledgeable of the cattle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them. This is the ayah that highlights the purpose of Eid al-Adha. Hajj is the ritual that Allah assigned to us, and we are supposed to be thankful for the gift of animals. Not because Ibrahim wanted to slaughter his child. It absolutely has no bearing and no relationship at all. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran has said that the Eid al-Adha, al-Hajj, is to mention the name of Allah in a set number of days. And the Eid al-Adha is to acknowledge the greatness and the gift of Allah to us for these animals. Please do not make the mistake in linking Eid al-Adha, when you sacrifice, to the story that took place between Ibrahim and his child. That once those docile, tamed, submissive animals are under our control by the sole gift of Allah and his authorization only, the divine instruction as to how their lives should be taken away. It is Allah who has given us those animals, and it is Allah only who can tell us how we can take their lives away. This is why we have not created the sheep, and this is why when we kill the sheep, we say Bismillah. What Bismillah means? It means, in the name of Allah, I take your right to live and eat you, because it's by authorization. A police person cannot arrest you except in the name of the law. You surrender to a police officer not because of who they are, not because of what they wear, or not because of their gender or their country. You surrender to them because they uphold the law. So they arrest you in the name of the law. That's why we surrender. The same thing, when we slaughter an animal, we take their lives away, we do it in the name of Allah. That's why they surrender to us, is because Allah made them to surrender to us. This is again further explained in Al-Quran, in Surah Al-Hajj, that is the Surah number 22. فَذْكُرُوا اسْمَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهَا صَوَافٍ. So mention the name of Allah over them, those cattle, when they are drawn up in lines, i.e. waiting to be sacrificed in Hajj. فَإِذَا وَجَبَتْ جُنُوبُهَا فَكُلُوا مِنْهَا وَأَطْعِمُوا الْقَانِعَ وَالْمُعْتَرِ. So when they fall, as you have slaughtered them, and after you do whatever it needs to be done, then you eat from it and feed the poor that are there asking, or those poor that are there sitting there waiting. كَذَلِكَ سَخَّرَهَا اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. As such, it is Allah who surrendered these beasts to you. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. So that you acknowledge that gift from Allah and be thankful to Allah for what He has gifted us of these animals. Throughout the year, we are eating meat, chicken, right? So how long can we really go on eating these without really being thankful to Allah for what He has gifted us? Eid al-Adha is our yearly event to be acknowledging and being thankful to Allah for all those animals that He has given us. Nothing else for Eid al-Adha. This is why a lot of people who do not understand the meaning of Eid al-Adha, to them is just to pay 60 pounds or 80 pounds or 100 pounds to some charity that is going to slaughter on their behalf, while these people don't even feel the power of what they have done. Imagine that. You go, you buy your own lamb if you can. If you cannot, then go to your local butcher, pay the money, and have them slaughter, and they bring meat, and you look at the corpse of the lamb, and you are there, and you say, Subhanallah, how Allah made it easy for us to have these animals, and we slaughter them, and we eat them. Imagine if Allah told us every year to sacrifice a lion. You actually have to go to the savannah in Africa, hunt for your lion or leopard or tiger, slaughter it and eat it. All of us will be dead. But look at the animals. You have a sheep. You have a cow. A big cow can be just dragged by a child. A camel, a little kid, a 10-year kid, a 5-year kid can take the lead and pull the cattle, and the cattle will follow him. That is the power of what Allah has given that. And just as usual, Shaitan does not want us to stay in peace. So he always tries his very best to inject something wrong in order to alter the purpose of what this majestuous relation that is religion brings to us. And he messes up, and he did mess up, and he is still messing up this beautiful celebration of Eid al-Adha. Because by the look of it these days, the meaning of Eid al-Adha to a lot of people has been so much altered that a lot of people not just think of it as an act to buy a sheep, pay someone to slaughter, and that's that. But to a lot of people, it has become a burden. So many Muslims today in the United Kingdom or in the West or maybe around the world, the kids, they don't even know what Eid al-Adha do. And so many of them, I've heard them with my own ears, they say that's animal cruelty. That is the price you pay for just giving 80 pounds or 100 pounds to Somalia or Pakistan or some Bangladesh to just slaughter the lamb there, and that is that. But as far as Allah is concerned, my dear sisters and my brothers, He is the Almighty, the Unneedy, the Eternal, the Rich, the King. This is why He openly declares unto us, لَيَّنَا لَاللَّهَ لُحُومُهَا وَلَا دِمَاؤُهَا. None shall reach Allah of its meat or its blood. What we do, Allah needs it not. So why has He given us Eid al-Adha? He further says, وَلَكِنْ يَنَالُهُ التَّقْوَى مِنْكُمْ. But it is your piety that reaches Allah. What does that mean? Is Eid al-Adha has to have a piety behind it. It's not about giving to a charity. And I really complain to Allah about those charity organizations that have become only a business ventures for a lot of people and how they are messing up our Islam today. Taqwa has to be existing in the Eid al-Adha that you performed. This is why Allah has given us those cattle and surrendered them to us. He says, كَذَلِكَ سَخَّرَهَا لَكُمْ. As such, so that your piety reaches Allah and you become pious, this is why Allah has submitted those cattle, and that is the sheep, the cow, the camel, the goat, and the such, to you. He made them submitted to us What for, Ya Allah? And then he says, so that you grandify Allah. لِتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ وَبَشِّرِ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. So that you grandify Allah for his guidance to you and bring the good news to those excellent doers. And the excellent doers are those who offer Eid al-Adha or go to Hajj with the purpose of performing excellence, not celebrating the slaughtering of one child and donating a lamb to some country, and that is that. So never link Hajj or Eid al-Adha to the past again. Rather, it is a special act of ritual to celebrate the great gifts that Allah has gifted us with, namely His guidance to us and also the docility of those beasts that are living amongst us, that serve us unconditionally. Imagine if we were again commanded that each of us every year had to hunt for an alligator, for a lion, for an anything. How would that be?
That's going to be difficult. Well, this is, I come to the end of part one of this beautiful talk about Al-Hajj, and I will, inshallah, see you on part two. This is again your brother, Abdusalam AbuHanifa. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.